Good morning. I'm a little too recently awake to be doing this, probably. I still have some pillow sleep lines on my face, but so be it. The inspiration comes. Here I am. I've been making a lot of changes of late. How about you? It's such a joy to know that we're all doing this together. You know, divide and conquer, separate, isolate, has been a real strategy of the powers that be. And we didn't realize it because we were all separated out and living our own individual life, not speaking up about so many things, and so not coming to find out, not realizing that others were going through so much the same thing, you know, with a different flavor, different details, but underlying the same thing. So there's a real joy in that, in a sense of community that I find in heart. And I want to celebrate that with you first. One of the things that happens with the changes that are going on in our consciousness, and they're so big, is that a book you read, a lecture you heard before, if you go back and listen or read it again, you'll hear
and see it differently. You'll pick up different things. The same words won't give you the same response. You'll have most likely a deeper understanding. I introduced in an earlier journal Inelia Benz and her interview by Bill Ryan of Project Avalon. And that's one of those that I want to soak up on the cellular level. And so I listen again and again. And I'll put it aside sometimes for a little while, a week or two, and then I'll go back. And I just listened to it again, sharing it with my friend, my house guest, and heard different things yet again. And I saw something else. And so what I want to share with you is that she is the empty cup. This is what emptiness looks like. And so I'm going to put the link to that lecture. No, it's not a lecture, it's an interview with the written and the video version of the journal here. And she has a website. It's ascension101.com. I'll put that link in too. This being, who isn't even really a being, has so much to offer. For those of you who might not have heard my previous introduction, Inelia has not incarnated before on Earth or anywhere. What she says is there was a great cry that came up from this planet to spirit of the beings that are being suppressed and repressed, and the suffering was intense. And so this is and she doesn't make herself anything special, but she says, I came from spirit. I wasn't an individual, a being, a soul. It was just spirit who separated out, if you will, and came into a body, got the agreement of the body before she came in, because free will reigns and rules here. And when she's finished with her mission here, she will go back to spirit. She won't go through the tunnel and into the light and have the life review, because she's not an individual. She's not a soul. She's spirit clothed in a body. And that's hard to take because we've never heard of anything like that. But I find her vibration to agree with her words, and I believe it. I accept it. So that being the case, here is someone without any more programming than you would get as a child in one lifetime. And so she came in with a clarity and a memory and an understanding and awareness that's, well, she's showing, like Anastasia in the Ringing Cedar series, the potential of the true human. She has many gifts, and, you know, she says all humans have this and can do this. We've just been convinced that we can't by our programming. And, you know, all of the overlay over the diamond, the spiritual diamond that each one of us is. And so I present her to you again as a vision of emptiness. Not just emptiness because she doesn't have all the programming, but emptiness because Inelia says she has one and only one mission, and she's very clear about it, has been since she was a child, and that's to raise the vibration of the planet. That's it. And in the things that she does, in the activities that she's guided to do as a part of this mission, she has a powerful intuition, for lack of a better word, connection with spirit. She has no curiosity about the results of her actions. She's empty of that. She could care, she could hardly care less. I mean, she just doesn't care. And it's beautiful. It's a good example that we don't often get to see. You might see it in a Buddhist monk somewhere, or a monk, or a recluse, you know, this detachment. But of course, in Inelia, it's somewhat different. I would say things are fresh and pure in her. And so I'll put those links in and recommend, you know, visit one or the other or both. I hope she and Bill will do another interview soon. Now, is that all I'm saying this morning? No. Okay. What else is in here? I don't know. I'm feeling somewhat less foolish, I guess. You know, there's been another thing coming to me, and that is that we all have a mind, we all have a brain, and we've gotten very used to using it. And actually, it's become a crutch, and we think we need it, and we don't realize we're spirit, and we don't. This is something we use, it's not something we need. And so, we've also taken the mind's way of viewing life as reality, and it's not. It is a perspective on that. And so, the mind's limitations are not ours. The mind is very linear. It's very useful, you know. I don't have anything against a mind. As I often say, the mind doesn't belong in the driver's seat. That's my gripe, if you will, with mind. As long as it stays out of the driver's seat, oh, it's a great thing, you know. All right, so one of the things that mind does is it separates things out. It picks them apart. That's how it studies them. You study the parts of a flower, the parts of the human body, the parts of this, that, or the other. That's a mind thing. And so we've taken reality and we've said these are the parts of reality. We have planes and we have dimensions and we have a clock that keeps time. So we have past, present, and future. And it's all very linear in its own way. And, you know, there's a certain utility to it, but we're transcending that now. And we're finding, I'm finding, that we have different ways to operate. Different entirely. It can contain that. It can contain all of that. It just isn't limited to that. And so Now, this is just a new perspective that I've been trying on of late. It just came through me to say to my friend, you know, we're operating here, we're interacting here at a fifth dimension level. That part of our being is what is in the exchange here. And it really seemed right, just the whole vision, to be able to see instead of this as opposed to that, instead of the polarity or the duality, and you try to take one side and then you try to see, well, what's the other side? How does that look? You know, the Republican and the Democrat, or the liberal and the conservative, or this religion and that religion, or the male and the female. The breaking it up way like that is to be in the third dimension with it. When your vision is to see the whole and to see it more as both sides of the very same coin, and in spite of the differences, there's still one, then you're on a higher dimensional level with it. Now, like I say, this is a perspective I'm working with. It's too new for me to be totally sure of it. I have to work with it a while, and I just listen in heart. But that's how it seems to me now. And then I found something on Inelia's website that totally supported that. She said, within 3D, you can, right where you are, right there in your body, access all of these other dimensions. So there's no going forth that needs to happen. There's no, well, I have to leave the body to rise in consciousness, or I have to wait until this mythical thing called ascension happens. Then I'll be in higher consciousness. Not so. Not so. I don't know what has been the truth in the past. I know that ascension has been the reality of how you graduate from one plane dimension density, I'm not sure of my words here, one density to the next, is an ascension. So we can ascend from 3D, and some of us will go into 4D, and some of us will go into 5, and some maybe 6. It depends on your consciousness. It's not a linear progression. It's not a stepladder. That's mind. That's mind's way of thinking. So whenever you catch it, you can say, ah, that's mind. I'm not limited to that. And mind may well be right, but even if it is, that's only a perspective on things. And we have flexible perspective. It's just a matter of exercising it, exercising this, so that we will be flexible. So we can experience the higher dimensions right where we are. Now, in the past, I think for the most part, when people ascended, they left the body behind and there was something to bury or cremate or whatever. The ones that did, like Jesus, were rare, who actually had the full mastery to take the body with them. It was more common to leave the body. You don't need it to ascend. There's something really special happening now. First of all, it's a whole planet. It's a whole solar system, really, that's ascending. Another perspective is that it's the sun, really, that's ascending. And the planets in the solar system are, if you will, the sun's body. And they are going along. So there are many, many ways to look at this. And I'm sure the beings on the higher densities and dimensions have a broader perspective, and who knows, maybe it's a galactic thing, universal. I don't know. I don't need to know. It's enough to know where I am. It's nice to know how everything fits, but it's really not necessary. And it will come when it comes, and that will be perfect. Okay. So for some, for whatever reason, you know, we're moving, we've got this galactic wave, or this not galactic. We've got a wave of energy coming, some say. I've heard a lot about this. What is her name who talks with the It won't come. Jadzik, Laura Knight Jadzik, has information about a wave that's coming, an energetic thing along the lines of a tidal wave or something. We know I almost want to say we're in the photon belt, the energy being emitted from the core of our galaxy, of the Milky Way. Our last eclipses have occurred at only 2 degrees off from galactic center. So this is the 2012 thing. The 2012 thing is measuring when we hit this perfect alignment with the center of our galaxy. So for whatever that's worth, that's what that is. So when we're talking about the photon belt or the energy from the center of the galaxy, we're talking about the 2012 thing. So that may be why things are so very different now. We're having mass ascensions, and not only that, but it's really special because everyone that wants to has the opportunity to take the body along. And thus, all of the little strangenesses that have been going on with our bodies of late, the internal changes are a part of that. If you're a light being and you have an intent to rise as much as you can in consciousness, you know, if that's the way you're focused and equipped and put together, then you're changing, you're converting from more of a fleshly body to something that's higher dimensional. So a light body, crystalline, and our DNA is changing, our very flesh is changing. The central nervous system is going through a lot. The endocrine glands are coming online. In a lot of us, the pituitary and the pineal gland, which are in the skull, in the head, have been kind of inactive, and they're coming online. I have been doing a tremendous amount of cleansing in the area of the eyes in many ways, not just, I spoke of losing, you know, as if I had dandruff. I kept losing tremendous skin. I mean, it would be white in the morning almost around the eyes, but it wasn't just that. I had loads of swellings and draining and just eye problems for a long time now. And I feel that that is related to those glands in the head being activated and coming up, you know, spinning up like you begin to spin your hard disk and it has to get up to speed before it's useful and functional. We'll be having the third eye open before too long. Maybe you're already having experiences with that, beginning to see little lights and different things where people are seeing orbs and those line things, rods, and just different things, some of which are higher dimensional. And so we'll be seeing more and more like the unlimited beings that we were, or that humans were created to be. With 12 strands of DNA, we have powers. We don't need spaceships to go anywhere. All right. The beings that we are divine and unlimited. And I've got chills. This is a personal confirmation for me. We are so unlimited. And I think, and I've heard it said, I forget whether it's Alex Collier or not, that some of the spaceships that we see are just projections of these higher dimensional beings because they know we want to see that. We're hungry for the reinforcements, you know. We know that we need help and support here because of the throttle hold of the dark cabal on the planet and the ones behind them, you know, that are pulling the strings. They're very powerful. Dark, yes, but they've twisted it so that it's the abuse of power. And so we want the help. And so a lot of these beings don't need spaceships to get anywhere.
You know, the mind is linear. It thinks you have to go from point A to point B, and you have to have a method to get there, something to carry you. You have to have a fuel of some kind. And it's all very linear, and it involves time in a way that time is going away. It's going to be no more like that. It won't take a period of time to heal. The healing will be instant. The traveling will be instant. And so we have a lot of changes ahead, and I don't know. I guess there's a bit of a peek into the future, quote unquote, as I see it. Remember, all is really now. All this is now. You're already ascended right now. If you're having future embodiments, you're having them now. All there is now. There's this great big cosmos to explore and to play with and to have fun with. But in a sense, it's now. And what one thing that this forces you to do is to get out of the head with it. In order to, it pretzels the brain. And in order to sit with it and be with it and have it make any kind of a sense, quote unquote, be in your heart and listen again and see how it sounds. There you go. Have a nice day.